I'm going to talk about biomechanics and my journey through that a bit, and then my journey through my clinical experiences, predominantly associated with deformity and myelopathy in patients with cervical spondylotic myelopathy. I have a disclosure that it has nothing to do with spine surgery. I'm going to initially talk about biomechanics of spinal column failure. This is the fundamental equation of spine biomechanics. Bending moment is the product of the force applied times the distance from an axis of rotation at which the force was applied. So a force applied at a distance d from an axis of rotation, we call it the instantaneous axis of rotation because it changes with time and motion, is the bending moment. Bending moments cause concentration of stresses. In this case, it initially caused the concentration of stresses ventrally, which initiated failure and then propagated dorsally. All points ventral to the IAR came closer together, and all points dorsal became farther apart. So if we instrument the spine, we're basically trying to prevent or correct deformity. And Archimedes stated, "Give me a lever long enough and a fulcrum on which to place it, and I shall move the world." And theoretically, at least, this is the case. We work around the X, Y, and Z axes of the Cartesian coordinate system. Again, this would be the center of the system. A force applied at a distance d creates a bending moment, which is the product of the force times distance, which causes a concentration of stresses. So we can prevent or correct deformity by six fundamental mechanisms. One is distraction. If we distract in the inner body region, we do not create a bending moment because we're distracting in the region of the instantaneous of rotation, axis of rotation. However, if we distract, for example, farther dorsally, we might cause a ventral bending moment. Three-point bending is another type of fixation, which is present when there are three or more fixation sites along the long axis of the spine. And in this case, there is a downward force at both ends and an upward force, which is equal to the sum of the two downward forces in the middle. We can use that obviously as a lever to correct deformity. We can also compress the spine. There are a variety of ways of doing that, including wires or clamps, etc. And then there are three types of cantilevers. A cantilever is a beam that is affixed to an immobile object at one end only. If it's rigidly affixed, like a screw that is rigidly affixed to a rod, we call it a fixed moment arm cantilever beam. But a beam could also be hooked, affixed to a immobile object by way of a hinge or a screw that toggles. It's still a beam, but we'll call this a non-fixed moment arm cantilever beam. And then we can apply bending moments with shant screws or cast bar pins, and we'll call that that type of a beam a fixed, an applied bending moment beam. The failure can occur in the spine by many mechanisms. Let's just talk about several of them. If I push in the middle of a tin can, it will dent in. If I push on the edge of the can, it is much more rigid. This is called the boundary effect. And hence, we may want to consider placing inner body struts or grafts or cages more towards the perimeter rather than the central portion of the end plate, taking advantage of the boundary effect. Screws fracture in interesting ways. This is a fractured screw at its base, and this is a screw that fractured near its tip. We might ask the question, why did that happen? And it gets back to some fundamental principles of biomechanics. that have to do with section modulus. For one, section modulus, or zeta, is equal to the third power of the inner diameter of a screw, or the diameter of a rod. It basically tells us how much strength the system has. Theta, or stress, is equal to the bending moment over strength, or section modulus. Implants always fracture at the point of maximum stress application. So this is a very important equation. So this implant fractures at a point where there is very little metal and a relatively long bending moment. And henceforth, the screw fracture occurs at this point. Additional factors that may have played a role is that this implant was bent prior to insertion in order to conform to the patient's contour of the spine. And when we bend a plate, it's going to predominantly bend where there is less metal or where the section modulus is diminished. And in those circumstances, it may have caused a stress riser that additionally led to this plate fracture. So why did this screw fracture and this screw fracture at the points where they did? Let's first take this screw. This is a fixed moment arm cantilever beam with a constant inner diameter screw. And so if we apply a force to the screw, the bending moment rises until we get to the plate. Since the inner diameter of the screw is constant, the stress also rises linearly and is maximum at the plate. So the stress, the denominator of this equation did not change as we go across the screw. And so the stress is maximum at this point. So this is a different scenario. This screw has a tapered inner diameter. And so the section bending moment still increases linearly as we go along the screw. But also as we go along the screw, since the section modulus is proportional to the third power of the diameter, the section modulus increases exponentially as we pass along the screw. And henceforth, if you look at the mathematics associated with this, where the numerator is increasing linearly and the denominator is increasing exponentially, we see the stress being maximum at a point somewhere near the tip of the screw, hence the fracture of the screw near its tip. Screws that toggle, or non-fixed moment arm cantilever beams, are usually fixed inner diameter screws, and they can windshield wiper through bone. And that can provide a form of dynamism, which allows bone to see bone healing enhancing forces. Here's another example of non-fixed moment arm cantilever beam screws in a mid-generation cast bar plate where the patient actually went on to fusion. And you say, well, how can that be when all these screws fractured? Well, let's look at the situation. When this spine subsided, the screws were exposed to three-point bending forces. And so screws that were in a hole in this implant were fractured because of these significant forces. So here's the AP view of this implant. On one side is a slot, on the other side are holes. Slot, holes, slot, holes, so on and so forth. All the screws in slots held, essentially, allowing the spine to subside along the axis designed by the surgeon by the contour, by virtue of the contour of the plate. And the screws in the holes were exposed to three-point bending stresses and henceforth fractured or backed out. Here's another example of that, a much simpler example. So implants function differently under differing loading conditions. I asked the question, nobody really has to answer this because I will answer it in a bit. Is there such a thing as a ventral compression implant in the cervical spine? The answer is yes, but in a way that you might not think of it. We know that we can compress from behind, but the question is, can we compress from in front? So if we compress from behind, we can use clamps or wires or a variety of strategies to compress the spine, but we really don't have a mechanism to do it in front unless you consider this. This is a fixed moment arm cantilever beam. In compression, when the spine is exposed to compression, this implant resists by distraction. So it's a distraction implant. It also is a cantilever beam. But when the patient attempts to extend his or her neck, this device actually resists that and henceforth is functioning as a compression device. And the only reason I'm bringing this up is because we need to be thinking of all the ways in which an implant or construct can fail and then act accordingly to prevent that. So this device then, in extension, acts as a compression device. So we have distraction, tension band fixation, three-point bending, and cantilevers or loading modes. What is missing here is an intermediate point of fixation, so we don't have three-point bending. This is a bridging implant with a high failure rate associated with multiple corpectomies, fibular strut, and then the bridging implant. You might say it fails because it doesn't resist axial loads very well. Well, that's probably not true. It relatively effectively resists axial loads, but what it doesn't resist is translation or rotation. And then henceforth, screw bone interface, the screw bone interface weakens and ultimately can fail as depicted in D. We could fix that by having an intermediate point of fixation so that the entire implant moves together and henceforth isn't exposed to the forces of translation and rotation that occur when there is no intermediate point of fixation. And henceforth, failure ultimately occurs in many of these cases. Again, we can prevent that by finding intermediate native vertebral bodies that we left and place screws into them. We could also do a ventral operation and a corpectomy and use a posterior approach to provide the intermediate points of fixation. As I will get into in a little bit, this takes away one of your major ways of correcting deformity, and that is bringing the bone to the implant. And it also requires two operations, and the patients that require these operations are often infirm or frail, and two operations stresses their system quite a bit. Okay, now I'm going to take us on my journey. Cervical spondylosis manifests itself to us as the surgeons in two ways predominantly, myelopathy or radiculopathy and deformity. Cervical spondylotic myelopathy is an encroachment and tethering problem, and it's a result of repetitive trauma to the spinal cord. These patients all have a cervical deformity. They have two things in common. The first is the kyphosis trapezius sign, where we see the trapezius muscle, which is an accessory muscle of neck extension that is not ergonomically placed well to achieve extension. But if the patient cannot extend the neck because they have a fixed deformity, or because if they have weak erector spinae muscles, the trapezius muscle is reflexively activated and henceforth can become a source of significant myofascial pain. But these patients all have back pain as well. Here is an example of such a patient who had an occiput to thoracic fusion for reasons that were unclear to us. But here she is with the kyphosis trapezius sign, and look at her posture. She is, her plumb line falls way dorsal to the lumbosacral pivot point, and henceforth There is a significant extension of the spine that must be achieved for her to look forward. Henceforth, the facet joints in the lumbar spine are excessively loaded. And here you can see a lady with the same thing. She's got a upper cervical kyphosis, and in order to look forward, she's got to bend her knees and arch her back and shift the axis dorsally considerably. So in correcting these deformities, we can use non-operative strategies that include posture. The first thing you tell an ankylosing spondylitis patient is please don't use pillows when you sleep, because they're going to exaggerate your flexion deformity, even in spite of the fact that it may make you more comfortable. And we encourage them to do exercises. This perhaps is the most important, to strengthen the erector spinae muscles in patients with the significant deformities. And although in very ill patients who are not candidates for surgery, I have not seen a correction of the deformity. I have seen patients who have reduction of symptoms by virtue of doing exercises aggressively. So surgical strategies. We know, this is work from Gogawala, that if we correct the SVA, cervical sagittal vertical axis, keep it under 13, 14 millimeters. This SVA is the distance between the C2 plumb line and the C7 plumb line in the standing position, that we will have much better health-related quality of life outcomes than if we don't correct it. And so if we end up with a 45 millimeter SVA, we are likely to see very poor health-related quality of life metrics, predominantly neck pain. So here's a patient that I failed. This is a pre-op flexion and extension x-ray. And I did this operation on her. Her myelopathy improved significantly, but she's unhappy because she has persistent neck pain. I did not achieve the amount of lordosis that I could have achieved preoperatively. And so I beg all of us to aggressively attempt to get the patients back into a good posture with an SVA under 13, 14 millimeters, if possible. Dan Rue, in his bivector technique, uses this strategy with Gardner Wells tongs and two different ropes, one rope going straight out and the other rope going up in order to correct deformity during surgery. And so here's the upward rope now being attached over the bar of a Jackson table down to some weights on the other side. This makes me nervous. In spite of the fact that there's a fail-safe here, the head moves around a lot, particularly when dissecting, and it's sort of like a bobbing spine as we operate. And henceforth, I'd rather use the three-point fixation with the Mayfield or equivalent head holders, and then repetitively, perhaps, maybe three or four times, go back and try to gain extension of the cervical spine as the spine relaxes in between times. It takes patience to correct cervical deformity. So why correct deformity? To diminish neck pain, improve myelopathy, decrease fusion degenerative changes, and improve short and long-term success. It is, we can use ventral or dorsal or combined approaches, and it's truly all about leverage. One of the simplest things we can is to use Caspar pins. I mentioned applying a bending moment earlier. This is an applied bending moment, putting the screws in a convergent manner and then straightening them out helps us correct a deformity. I also address through the implant.
Ed, can I ask you one quick question?
Sure, I'm sorry.
Going back to what we were talking about before, are you going to talk about cervical parameters and T1 slope and cervical lordosis and how they're related?
Yes, I am.
Okay, I won't say anything else then.
Okay, you can talk all you want.
No, I was just gonna just tell people that I always pay attention to the T1 slope, because that'll determine how much lordosis you need to get.
Right. I'm gonna address that with a couple of cases.
Okay, I'll just.
So we bring the bone to the implant here. Here's the picture of that. You serially tighten each of the right and the left screw and convert a kyphosis into a lordosis, as depicted here. We use gravity. The weight of the head is about 10 pounds. In the supine position, we can take advantage of that and use the phenomenon of viscoelasticity, which is the gradual deformation of a body, in this case, the cervical spine, when exposed to a constant load. So this is a 72-year-old lady who's undergone multiple ventral and dorsal operations. Greg, you have something? No, okay. But multiple ventral and dorsal operations and a kyphotic deformity. She's got the kyphosis trapezius sign and again, a progressive myelopathy. She really has no place along her course here, the spinal cord, where there is significant compression, and there's a signal change in an area where there's very little compression. So I want you to keep in mind, this is the beginning of my clinical journey. I saw this patient 20 years ago, and we all know now what we didn't know then. So I knew we could correct ventrally because her facets were not ankylosed. You can see this extension x-ray, she's fish mouthing just below the fusion. And so we put her on an operating table with a cushion or a donut under her head and it rolls under her shoulder. And began doing our dissections, et cetera, relaxations, discectomies. And then we took the pillow away and allowed the head to gradually extend. Then we used trapezoidal bone grafts and brought the bone to the implant and converted a 15-degree kyphosis to a 5-degree lordosis. This isn't perfect, but sometimes almost perfect is good enough when the cost of trying to get even more is significant. And I don't mean cost in dollars and cents, I mean cost in morbidity and potential mortality. And it's all about leverage. So if we're doing the cases prone, adjust the head holder over and over until you achieve this, and don't be satisfied with this. I would like you to look at what this patient here looks like at the C23 disc space angle, which I'm going to address in a bit. She's horizontal to the floor here. That's where you want her to be. Look where I put her C23 disc angle. It's at a downward slope, if you will, in the fused position. Fixation follows. Okay, here she is post-op. First of all, we have her well decompressed. Second of all, her signal change went away. So she improved significantly clinically in all aspects. Her myelopathy improved, her neck pain improved, and she was very happy. So here's the way she looked pre-op and post-op, and we say, we're glad she's better, let's just move on. So we thought long and hard about it. It wasn't too much later that this fellow came in, 68 years old, who'd had a laminectomy 10 years prior for myelopathy, and he improved. Now his myelopathy is returning, and he has wide open spaces on his MRI scan. How are we going to deal with this? Is this some sort of a neurodegenerative disorder or what? Well, if we go back to the beginning of my talk here, we talked about cervical spondylotic myelopathy being a manifestation of repetitive trauma and tethering or distraction. So if we extend his spine, or he extends his spine, he moves at every level, but he can't extend past this point due to arthritic changes in his facet joints, but he can most certainly flex well. So Lee said, let's get a flexion extension MRI. And here's his flexion view. So every time he flexes his spine, he severely compresses his spinal cord. And this may be a picture of a post-laminectomy membrane that people talk frequently about. So here's extension or neutral, and this is flexion. So we knew we could fix him dorsally, as I mentioned before. And so we did facet osteotomies at multiple levels and then instrumented him and fused him. And we pounded our chest and said, this is good. He was happy. His myelopathy improved. But he came back later with this. He topped off at C2-3. So first of all, we didn't know and didn't achieve a horizontal C2-3 disc space. Second of all, he had two operations at which the C2-3 facet capsule could have been injured or disrupted to some degree or another. But we also have a long construct going up to C3, and henceforth C2-3 failed. So he underwent by his primary surgeon this operation. It's very difficult to get correction at C2-3 when you have that type of a deformity from behind. But he was actually very happy with this, in spite of the fact that his C2-3 was still sliding downward, but C2 was included in the construct. And I think that's a very important variable that we will talk about in a bit as well. So I have a very low threshold to take a fusion up one level. If I only really need to go to 3 and it's a long fusion, I will take it to 2 almost automatically to eliminate this problem. You lose very little rotation and flexion extension. So here's another fellow who presented with a C7-T1 herniated disc from trauma, and he had an operation elsewhere and had this device placed and then taken out because he had neck pain. And he had neck pain because this is his posture. This is MRI, no myelopathy or anything. This is what he looks like. He's got a positive a kyphosis trapezius sign. Some people call this the cobra sign, looks like a cobra's neck. And he's also got back pain, as you can see how his increased lordosis in an attempt to look forward. So we did multiple level facet osteotomies, took down his old fusion, and then flipped him over, combined approach, and did multiple level discectomies, used trapezoidal fibular strut grafts that I formed myself, and then a multiple level construct where we were allowed or able to bring the bone to the implant. And so here he is pre-op, and here he is post-op. Clear improvement, if not complete resolution, of his kyphosis trapezius sign or cobra sign. Sometimes we need to correct at a different level. This is a lady with an ear on shoulder deformity. She has neurofibromatosis, ectatic vessels, and a slight scoliosis in the thoracic spine, vertebral artery ectasia. An old clamp was placed here. So she's got an occiput to C2 fusion, which is solid. And here is her head tilted onto her neck. Here you get a feel for the amount of tilt of her head based on this coronal CT cut. So here she is pre-op. So we decided that it's best to stay away from the pathology at the occiput to C2. There's just a significant amount of bone here. And we started doing osteotomies from C2 down to C6. And I then went below the table and moved her. We started with her head tilted like she normally is, and then I straightened it out so that she was looking straight forward. And then we finished the osteotomies. This one here, when we did it, actually was associated with a auditory pop. So I bring that up because the patient should be aware, and you and the surgeon should look for any potential reasons that the vertebral artery could be injured with such a case, because suddenly stretching the vertebral artery over an osteophyte or something like that could have very hazardous consequences. So here is her post-op, intra-op, post-procedure intra-op picture. And the radiologist report on this was quite humorous, talking about screws going every which way. And I explained to the patients preoperatively that we need to take advantage of the anatomy that's presented to us. And sometimes the fixation postoperatively can have a odd appearance. Here is her picture post-op and pre-op, and she was very happy. This was actually a cosmetic operation, although we didn't list it at that. She says, it's really hard to get a date when your ear is on your shoulder. Here she is in good sagittal balance, coronal balance, postoperatively, and she was very happy with this. Sometimes we should stage procedures. This lady had multiple ventral and dorsal procedures, had a progressive myelopathy, and this CT scan, and for obvious reasons, we did not feel it was a good idea to operate on her ventrally. So we took her to the operating room and performed a laminectomy, facet osteotomies, and felt we could not get a good correction. We really could only see down to C2 or halfway down C2 because this was in the pre-O-arm days. We took her back upstairs and we put a log roll under her shoulder, put her into extension with slight traction with Gardner Wells tongs, and got another CT scan 4 or 5 days later. And we see here that we've got good correction. And we said, we're gonna take this. So we took her to the operating room and fused from C2 to T3 or T4. And please excuse me for having crosslinks here, but this was in the day when I used crosslinks. I think they're unnecessary today. Having said that, we used viscoelasticity, gradual creep of the spine and deformity correction over time. Here she is preoperatively. Here she is in the CT scan in between operations. So this is what I mean by a facet osteotomy. You go all the way through, not 99%, but all the way through, and make sure you stay dorsal to the nerve, make sure you've checked your preoperative anatomy for anomalous vertebral arteries, et cetera. And then if you stay dorsal to the nerve, the artery is always ventral to the nerve. And then here she is post-op. And here she is clinically post-op. She was happy. So we did a study looking at a large population of patients undergoing cervical fusions and looked at the effect of the C2-3 angle post-operatively on outcome. And all of these parameters were statistically significant when we inadequately corrected the C2-3 angle. The reoperation rate was higher, pseudoarthrosis rate was higher. There was progressive kyphosis, adjacent segment degeneration, and disease. So Greg Trost mentioned the C7-T1 slope. This patient is actually, in most of the subaxial cervical spine, in a lordotic posture. And yet she has a profound sagittal plane kyphotic deformity. So if we look at the C7T1 angle, or the T1 slope as it's called, and it's significantly angled downward as depicted here, we are dealing with essentially a cervical thoracic C7T1 and below deformity. It's really not a cervical deformity, and we must address it accordingly. So I use the C23 angle for intraoperative utility. It also tells us about postoperatively if the patient has complications or not, or may have complications, but wouldn't it be nice to prevent complications? And then use the C23 angle as a barometer or a guide to the extent of deformity correction. So if we end up with something like this, we're going to have a significantly increased chance of having a persistent neck pain problem and a persistent problem with the deformity and changes at the C23 space. So this lady previously had a lumbar fusion, but now is complaining of severe neck pain and a kyphosis trapezius sign. As you see, she's has a positive SVA in spite of the fact that she's got a somewhat of a lordosis. So she has in the upper thoracic spine some kyphotic deformity, which if corrected, might make her symptoms better. So we did not attack the cervical fusion that she already had. We simply took out the old screws and put in new ones. But we did facet osteotomies at 6771 and then 72, C7T1, T1, T2, T2, T3. And you can get about 10 degrees, maybe, or at least 5 degrees per level. She did not need a lot, as you can tell. And we use the intraoperative x-ray to look at the C23 angle. One, if you take this x-ray and turn it 90 degrees to the counterclockwise, you can get a feel for what the C23 angle is going to be. Now, I emphasize that you're gonna lose a little when the patient actually is fused and standing postoperatively, but it gives you a nice barometer to say, I am done. I have achieved the angle, the amount of correction that I need with the procedure that I have done. And so here she is, pre-op and post-op. So interestingly, her C23 angle is tilted down. She's almost perfectly corrected with the C23 angle post-op, but at her plumb line from C7 was relatively normal pre-op, but it's artificially normal because she was leaning backwards in order to see forward. And so now that her neck is fixed, she then gravitates back to what would be her natural plumb line, which is in kyphosis in the lumbar spine. That did not seem to bother her because she had back pain, which was actually improved with this operation as well. If we want to do questions, I could stop here and not cover total disc arthroplasty. Nikolai, what would you like?
Well, I would say maybe you continue because total disc arthroplasty is something that is really hot topic now, and it's been like that for the last year. Okay. So I think it's going to be interesting to hear your opinion on that.
So Nikolai, just so you know, this turns out usually to be the Greg Trost, Ed Benzel humor hour.
That I know that, and I know that this is going to be interesting for the rest to see. So I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, so I want to make it clear that I'm just telling you what I see from a biomechanical perspective. I'm not talking about clinical outcome at all.
I don't have the opportunity to present my arthroplasty talk. So I probably won't say much. I do have an arthroplasty case though in the case section.
Okay. That's great. That's great.
So motion along which axis? This is a metal on poly disc. It's very rigid, so it transmits loads. And it's a ball and socket joint essentially, so it has very little flexion resistance to flexion and extension, which is quite different from the normal disc. So normally, what we'd like to do when a spine is looks like this. This is a stress strain curve of a mechanically unstable disc. And the hallmark of that is a widened neutral zone. The neutral zone is larger. It is a sloppier motion segment. So knowing that, we can look at the flexion and extension, or excuse me, the stress and the strain in flexion and extension. It's basically very small. With a the neutral zone is widened because it doesn't resist flexion and extension. That's just the disc itself. The body reacts to that and stiffens the joint. But is that what we want? I don't know. If it's an elastomeric disc like this Acroflex disc that ultimately failed at the rubber metal interface where it delaminated. It probably looks something like this. If we use a Dynasys system or any other posterior dynamic stabilization device, it should shift the curve back. It should stiffen the spine, but it also probably shifts the instantaneous axis of rotation, which is why these systems aren't associated with significant clinical benefit. And then if we do a fusion, it's instructive to think about the nature, what does it look like on the stress strain curve? Well, there it takes a lot of force to create any motion. And so the curve goes basically straight up. So if we look at stiffness in axial loading, I'm sorry about this slide. We see that it becomes, the artificial disc becomes very stiff in axial loading. So it really, in effect, transmits loads to adjacent segments and potentially to the facet joint. The same, that this looks about the same as it did with flexion extension and similarly with the Dynasys system and similarly with a fusion. So adjacent segments and same segments, we've really got to be concerned about that because the it may actually stress adjacent segments. So I'm just going to briefly go through some of the literature that has preceded artificial discs by a long time, the common use of artificial discs, and look at adjacent segment degeneration and adjacent segment disease, which is symptomatic degeneration at a segment adjacent to an index level. So Hillebrand et al. From Philadelphia, did a number of studies looking at ACDF and adjacent segment disease and found that there was somewhere between a 1.5 and 4% rate of adjacent segment disease, let's just say 3% for the purpose of this conversation, after a fusion. Interestingly, a huge study with 846 laminal foraminotomies, the authors from Minnesota in 1983 demonstrated adjacent disease rate at about 3% per year adjacent to a laminal foraminotomy, a motion sparing operation. The group from Pittsburgh looked at patients with anterior cervical discectomies with and without fusion and found that there was no difference in adjacent segment disease at about 3% per year in both groups. And then Hildebrand looked at the incidence of adjacent segment disease with multiple level fusions in the cervical spine and found that the annual incidence actually went down, not up, of adjacent segment disease compared to one level operations. I'm not sure why that is, but it is probably related to the fact that if you did the two levels that are most vulnerable to degeneration are 5-6 and 6-7. If you fuse one, the other one is exposed to greater stresses. If you fuse both, both vulnerable discs have been taken out of action. Now, I'm not recommending we do two-level discectomies and fusions. I'm just saying that that could be a factor, or we may be just dealing with natural history. And there is ample literature supporting the fact that abnormal posture of a disc or a motion segment leads to both excessive biomechanical stresses at adjacent segments, and number two, increased clinical changes associated with symptomatic degenerative changes. So when we think about this, if we have a kyphotic posture, we're gonna be stressing that adjacent C2-3 joint. And so henceforth, we should tend to want to correct posture as much as possible. And so two discectomies, both of them have great initial postoperative courses. And although I don't know how this patient did, I can tell you that the chance that he will have adjacent segment degenerative changes is much greater than this patient who was left in a kyphotic or lordotic posture postoperatively. And so we should aggressively strive to achieve correction of deformity. Thank you very much.